paddling down rivers with current is awesome. It's like being on a conveyor belt through the outdoors. But paddling anywhere that has current does have dangers, hazards, especially if you don't know what to look for or you don't know how to deal with the different situations that often arise. So that's what this video is about. It's about identifying the hazards, but also it's about some paddling techniques for paddling in current, paddling down rivers. Before we get right into it though, I need to take a quick second to thank Kayaking for sponsoring this video. Now Kayaking, they make waterproof cases for your phone, but they're more than just waterproof cases. They're really an insurance policy for your phone because they're not just waterproof, but they float as well. Because a waterproof case doesn't do you much good if your phone's at the bottom of the lake or the river. You can check out Kayaking at kayaking.com. All right, so let's get right into it. Before we start talking about paddling techniques though, let's talk about some personal limitations to paddling in moving water. Because the reality is, when you're paddling in moving water, things can get out of hand pretty quickly. So that's why if you don't have any formal current paddling in current training, you need to stick to class one water. And what is class one water? Well, class one water is basically just fast moving or slow moving water with very small, if any, waves and no real obstructions to navigate around. Now, class two water is faster moving water with significant waves, rocks or other obstructions that you have to navigate around. Once you get into class two water, well, things have the potential of snowballing out of control pretty quick. That's actually where most accidents happen, is people without training in the wrong equipment push their limits a bit in class two or beyond whitewater. They don't know the real hazards to worry about, and they don't know about the situations or how to deal with the situations that pop up, and things can get out of control. And so we, in this video, we're talking about paddling in rivers with class one moving water. Now that can still be fast moving water, don't get me wrong, but it's very straightforward current. Now, first off, you need to understand some of the key hazards that can be found on flowing rivers. And the first one is strainers. Now, what a strainer is usually a fallen tree or a log jam, something that is obstructing the river. The water can go right through it, no problem, but it strains anything bigger. And it's a great place for paddles, boats, and people to get stuck. And the pressure of the current, which is deceivingly strong, even in mild current, can hold you there and prevent you from getting out of there. This is strainers are very potentially deadly places to be. And so we want to avoid strainers at all costs. So any creek or river you paddle on, be on the lookout for fallen trees, log jams, anything that'll act as a strainer. And just because it wasn't there yesterday, it doesn't mean it isn't there today. Another major hazard on flowing rivers is low head dams and weirs. Now, over the past couple of decades, a lot of low head dams and weirs have been removed because of their danger factor. In fact, they've often been referred to as drowning machines because they are so dangerous. They're so dangerous because they're very benign looking. The water is very smooth leading up to them, and it pours over this natural, this man-made smooth concrete surface and creates this very gentle foamy hole at the bottom. Well, that hole at the bottom is very often a keeper hole. It doesn't let things out to go in. And that's what makes them drowning machines. And so you should know beforehand if the river or creek, the waterway, has any low head dams or weirs on it. And if it does, avoid them like the plague, no matter how fun they look. Now, a last hazard that deserves special mention is foot entrapment. Now, foot entrapments happen when people stand up in fast moving water. And what happens is you can't see where you're putting your feet. And so if you step in a gap between rocks or maybe a log in a rock, who knows what's on the riverbed. Your foot goes in there and gets stuck. The power of the current will blow you over and now you're stuck underwater. And that can, you can literally drown in a couple of feet of water, you know, water that's less than waist height. Because of a foot entrapment. And that's why whenever you're swimming in fast moving water, your best course of action is to swim yourself right up to shore, get out there and climb out. And you might take an extra little knock or two on your knees getting there, but that sure beats the alternative. Okay, so now that I have possibly completely freaked you out about paddling on rivers, let me go back to my first point about paddling on flowing rivers. It's awesome. It's totally awesome. So as long as you're aware of those dangers, then you can have a wonderful time on the river. Let's start though by talking about basic river dynamics. Like when you look at a flowing river, in very simple terms, you have two parts of the river. You've got the main current, that's very obviously the main flow going down, and then you have eddies. And eddies are the calm spots that are formed by something that's obstructing the main flow. So maybe you have a boulder in the middle of the main flow and the water just can't go through the boulder, so it gets pushed around it. In behind that boulder, you have a calm spot called an eddy. They can be formed from points off the side of the river. In behind points, you have eddies. Along the shorelines, you have a lot of eddies of different sizes. You can have eddies behind islands. You know, you'll have a lot of eddies on rivers, and these are your safe zones where the main flow isn't hitting it. It's not as fast. That being said, the eddy line, which is where the main flow and the eddies meet, that's where you get this funny water, boils, whirlpools. That funky water there is the most unstable water on a river. It's more unstable to be on the eddy line than in the main flow. And so, as a general rule, you want to avoid hanging out on the eddy line. You want to either be in the eddy, in that calm water, or in the main current. All right, so you now know you want to spend all your time either in the main flow or in the eddy, where I am right now, and you want to avoid hanging out on the eddy line. So the big question is, how do I move from the eddy into the main flow? Now, when we're dealing with class one moving water, which we are right here, this is fast moving water, class one, it's not that big of an issue. The faster the water's moving, the more of an issue it becomes and more important it becomes that you get this right. When you get into class two and three, you absolutely need to use the right technique or you are going to flip. Now, the technique is really quite simple. What I'm going to do is I'm going to get some speed. Now, I don't want to cross the eddy line at 90 degrees, not perpendicular. I don't want to punch straight into the current that way. I want to actually angle my boat a bit upstream. Now, as soon as my boat enters that main flow, that current's going to take my bow downstream. It's going to make my boat carve downstream. Whether you're skiing, biking, or kayaking, anytime you're carving a turn, you're making a turn, what do? You lean into that turn. If you don't lean into the turn, well, you're probably gonna eat it. And that's what's gonna happen kayaking in strong current. And so in this case, my bow is gonna get taken left. I'm gonna turn, carve to the left, so I need to be leaning the boat to the left in anticipation of that. And when I say leaning the boat or tilting the boat, it's not leaning your body out to the left. All I'm doing is I'm shifting my weight from both butt cheeks onto a single butt cheek, in this case, the left-hand butt cheek, and that naturally puts this boat on a nice edge, perfect for carving a turn. Now let's see how that looks in action. All right, so I'm starting with a little bit of speed, not too much, pointing slightly upstream, my weight's on my left butt cheek, and I'm carving a turn to the left. I'm keeping my weight on the left butt cheek, once I'm moving the same speed as the current, well, it doesn't really matter which way I'm leaning the boat because I'm going the same speed as the current. Now, the same thing applies when you're moving from the main flow into the eddy. Is you're coming in from the main current, you've got speed, and then you're hitting this slow moving water, so your boat is gonna wanna carve a turn. And so you have to lean your boat into that turn. So coming into an eddy, I get some speed. As I approach the eddy line, I have to anticipate my boat wanting to turn, so I shift my weight to my left butt cheek, and my boat carves a turn into the eddy. Now, this kayak, it's not a highly maneuverable kayak. It's designed to track, to go straight. And so this one isn't carving as an aggressive turn as some kayaks will. The more maneuverable your kayak is, the shorter and less of a keel it has on it, the more it'll wanna carve a turn, and the more you'll have to edge your kayak. It really depends on the kayak you have, but the concepts are the same. You're shifting your weight onto one butt cheek or the other, depending on which way you're carving. Now, if you're in the main current and you encounter some real waves, how do you deal with those? Well, the best way to deal with waves is to point your boat straight into them, stay forward, and just paddle through them. You don't need to paddle aggressively through them, just paddle your way through those waves. Now, depending on how big those waves are, some of those waves may break over your kayak and into your kayak. Now, if you're in a sit-on-top kayak, that water will just drain through the scupper holes. If you're in a sit-inside kayak like I am, that water's going in the boat to stay. And that's why I bring, and you should bring as well, a sponge to get rid of small amounts of water that might come in, or a bilge pump. And a bilge pump is a way to empty a boat if a lot of water has gotten into it, or if you've completely swamped. And the way this works, without filling up my kayak, if you can imagine my kayak's full of water, and I'm doing this in my kayak, you just pump, and it's pulling the water out of my kayak and shooting it out. Now, something that does happen fairly frequently on flowing rivers, especially nice calm ones, is you're not always pointed straight down. You might just be floating downstream, not really paying attention, which is probably not a great idea. But if you go sideways into a rock or maybe even a submerged log, usually a rock, the natural reaction when you're, if I float sideways into a rock, is to lean away from that rock, like, oh, I'm hitting a rock. The problem with doing that is the water that's the main flow that's coming down here is going to hit your upstream edge. Now, I'm no longer moving. The rock has stopped me, so I'm no longer moving the same speed as the current. And so that water is going to pile up on that edge and push it down, and it can easily flip the kayak upstream. So your best course of action, rather than leaning away from the rock that you're floating into sideways, is exact opposite. Love that rock. Lean into it. Give it a hug. Maybe not a hug, but lean into it, and then just grab with your hand and push yourself off and around. And by doing that, you'll float into it, and the water will just stay underneath your boat, and you'll just get pushed around the rock and continue downstream. All right, so now you're in the situation where you went into that rock sideways and you did exactly what I said not to do. You leaned upstream and you caught your edge, and now you've flipped your kayak. Or maybe one of your buddies just thought you looked a little hot and decided to flip you, push you in, whatever. You're swimming. If you're swimming in a flowing river, if you're paddling a sit-on-top kayak, you can, if you know how to hop back in, you can just hop back in, but avoid the temptation of standing up or trying to stand on the river bottom to push yourself up, because that's again where foot entrapments can occur. Now, if you aren't paddling a sit on top, you're paddling a sit inside kayak and you can't just climb back in your boat, or maybe you're paddling a sit on top kayak and you can't get back onto it, then what you have to do is grab the end of your boat, grab your paddle with your other hand, and swim your boat to shore. Really, you're gonna be kicking yourself to shore. Even better though, is give your paddle to your buddy. You shouldn't be paddling flowing rivers alone anyway. You should have a buddy with you, at least one. So they should be able to take your paddle. You can drag your kayak to shore where you can just empty the water out, start all over again. If there's something downstream that you're worried about, or you don't know what's downstream, then your gear can be replaced. So don't worry about your gear, get yourself to shore, and then your friends can chase your gear, get your gear somewhere downstream. Now, when I was thinking about what to talk about in this video, it was actually pretty tricky because, you know, we're opening Pandora's box a bit here in terms of the things that we could cover. Because paddling in flowing rivers, this is just the very beginning right now. And once you get into class 2, 3, 4, white water and moving water, there's a whole lot more things to consider and a lot more paddling technique that comes into play. But what I want this video to be is really a video for untrained paddlers who paddle on flowing rivers. They're not whitewater paddlers, just recreational paddlers who love paddling on their local river that has current. And this video is designed to make that experience as safe as possible. Because again, I said it at the beginning, I've said it probably a couple times, the thing about flowing rivers, anytime you have fast moving water, is that things have the potential of spiraling out of control if you don't know what to watch out for and how to deal with the very simple situations that can arise. And hopefully now I've provided a little bit of clarity on those situations, what to avoid, the hazards, and how to deal with those things that pop up. I hope this has been helpful. We are going to get into some more in-depth river running videos later on, where we talk about class 2, 3, and 4, more specialized paddling techniques. Stay tuned for that stuff. So subscribe to Paddle TV if you haven't already. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. Leave a comment down below. Tell me what tips you'd like to see next, and stay tuned because we got lots more paddling stuff coming your way.